Welcome to this episode of Ink Drawing and Watercolor Wash. As you can see, we're looking at some photos from Meijer Garden. Butterflies are in bloom. This picture right here. Actually, this one is the one we're going to paint. This is a waterfall that's inside of their arboretum, their greenhouse, their large greenhouse with tropical plants and so forth. They run this event in the spring where they bring a bunch of butterflies, cocoons to come out, and everybody gets to see them. They fly around inside of the greenhouse, and there's quite a variety to be seen. It's very nice to go to Meijer Garden in the winter when the weather's not really great out, because they have this indoor greenhouse. It's very large. They have an arid section with cactuses and so forth, and they have this tropical area. So today we're going to draw, or to paint, this waterfall area. Now, the original picture is quite dark, and we're probably not going to go that dark. I think I'm going to choose some lighter colors and make it a little more spring-like. You can also see me doing some pretty detailed leaves. I don't always do that. I kind of usually suggest them. But my wife did a watercolor painting of a nest with some Easter eggs in it, and she did a lot of details on the twigs that made up the nest, and I thought, yeah, I need to do that. I'm gonna be a little more detailed. But as you're gonna notice, it's really this left side that is gonna be kind of like that, and a lot of the rest of the painting will be more washes and mixture of colors. So it'll be a good contrast between, you know, those sharp lines and more of a softer watercolor effects that you get. So as you draw, just take your time to get the sizes and the shapes as accurate as you can. Always be aware of perspective and proportion. Perspective is how things kind of go off to a vanishing point, and proportions is like how big each item is compared to the other items. So there, the pencil drawing's done. I'm about to find some markers. These markers come in a variety of sizes, actually maybe too many sizes. Try to find the right ones, the right thicknesses. You can use your little scrap paper to see what the lines are going to look like. And I'm going in and doing the ink. Outlines. You can see my family is making art with me, which I think is a lot of the fun of making art, is seeing how each person's personality and style comes out. We're all very different, so don't feel like you need to imitate my style. The point is to see that you can create art that matches your interests, that matches your style. Right now I'm doing a natural scene. I've been doing a lot of lighthouses. I'll probably continue to do a lot of lighthouses since we live in West Michigan near Lake Michigan. Recently did the Big Red Lighthouse in Holland. Not all of these places I'm going to be visiting, at least not right away, hopefully eventually. So you can go online and find pictures to choose from. Maybe famous buildings or bridges or boats or airplanes or tourist attractions. Or you can go in your own area and drive around and see if you can find something that's interesting at a park or a historical site. Got again, when I talk about proportion, you want the waterfall to be the right height, you want the pool to be the right size compared to how high up the leaves go. I often just don't match the original too perfectly, which is all right. Now, letting the ink dry, you can go over with the eraser and get rid of a lot of those smudges. You want to get that off there before you put the watercolor washes on. Make sure the ink is dry. So there is the pen and ink drawing. As you can see, the stuff on the left is a little darker. I use a thicker line, and the stuff on the right I use a thinner line. I do want to warn you, the video stopped recording at about 40 minutes. I'm mostly done. I will bring in a short video near the end where I kind of point out some of the things that I did to finish it off. Point is, don't be discouraged if things don't always work out the way you expect them. I'm learning how to do these videos and didn't want to waste this effort. The painting turned out fairly nice. So you see me looking at the sheen of the water. You want it to be damp but not too wet. And then you kind of go right into the paint, which is a little bit wet. You can see when you rub the brush on it, it is already a little bit wet, but it's not really soupy or anything like that. So you're bringing in some pretty strong colors. You don't want every aspect of this wall or any item to be too uniform, especially in natural scenes. It's that variation that you see in real life that you don't always quite understand what it is, but it's different colors and light reflecting, and there's darknesses and there's contrast between textures, light and color, and that's what makes a painting look good, is when there are those contrasts. You see I'm adding a little more water. Things were drying up as I was going. Yes, bottom area, I'm making it a little bit more brown. That area's a little more of a traditional brown, less of the orangish and yellowish. So you need to decide, do you do the detail first and then the background, or vice versa? There's something called mascoid. It's a kind of like a rubber cement. It dries white, and you could paint this rubber cement type mascoid into those flowers and leaves and let it dry, and then you could do that whole brown area there is one big wash right over the mascoid, and then once that's dry you can peel the mascoid off by rubbing it, and then you could go in and do those colors. So I would definitely get the artist grade. I think I use Winsor Newton, but I wouldn't use rubber cement. Use the materials that are actually recommended. I use Winsor Newton paints. This is a little travel kit. I think I've used Arches paper and Winsor Newton paper. This is like 130-pound cold press. It has a texture. It's not an artificial manufactured looking texture. I don't really care for those papers. So I would probably recommend you stay away from those. If you're gonna do a lot of watercolors. I bought a pack of, I don't know, 40, maybe 50 sheets of something around 3 foot by 4 foot, and cut in half is a nice large painting. Cut into 8 by 10s, you get maybe 4 or 6 panels, maybe even 8, I'm not sure. Cut into these 5 by 5s, you can get almost 15 or 20 of them. So this is another tree, going in with some yellow, adding a little green. As you saw with the water area, again, I painted it in with clear water, added a little blue, and then I added some streaks. This is really a lot like coloring. When I taught my kids to color, I said, okay, go ahead and color that leaf green. Now let's go back and take a black crayon and kind of give it some volume. You know, shade up the side. In this case, I'm adding a darker green to the left side of each leaf. I add a little brown to where the little line in the middle was. You don't want the leaf to be all the same tone. You want some yellow, you want some green. And that's kind of the whole idea with watercolors. You can do that with all of your areas of the painting. Now, when they get small, like these leaves, you know, I don't bother with the shadowing, the shading too much. You can, with a real small brush, you can go in and kind of paint a black line along one of the edges. Here's my coffee cup. Always enjoy coffee. I also have my music playing. Nice relaxing music, some coffee, some paints, family, the cat's even with us. Just enjoy the day. Now I just took that over to the hairdryer and blew some hot air on there and got everything to dry up. If you're painting on site and you don't have access to a hairdryer, you could wave it around, obviously. Small painting, you can wave it around to get it to dry. Or you can just kind of plan what section of the painting you're working on. You know, work on the left side while it dries, you work on the right side. You see me pushing paint around with the tip. And sometimes if you go too dark, you can squeeze out the paint from your brush, the water, and then kind of go in and tap, and it will actually suck some of the water and some of the paint out. You can use a paper towel or a Q-tip as well. And while I often teach to not be afraid to go dark, sometimes you can go too dark. So you need to learn over time, either through mistakes or experimenting, to see how much paint you can get off the paper. Because sometimes you will make it a little too bold and you need to get some of that off. So one technique is just to take clear water and paint over it, and then take your brush and try to suck some of that color out. Or can see I actually went into that other section a little bit. Just took a paper towel and dabbed it out. It's going to be painted over, so it's not a big deal. Watercolors can be somewhat unforgiving. If you're doing acrylic, you can usually paint over things. Some situations better than others, but watercolor, you kind of, if you put a big dark area in and want to make it light, you're probably not going to have a lot of success. So watercolor is a lot about planning. It's also about playfulness. experimenting, expressing yourself. You know, how detailed do you want to be? How realistic do you want to be? And you can see I'm putting that dark color in, and I have these little squiggly lines going from top to bottom, and I'm kind of pushing the paint into the squiggles, but leaving that middle channel there to represent the waterfall. So I had a little splotch of brown down there, and I kind of was wetting it and trying to wash it off with my paper towel. It wasn't really going away, so I decided to kind of just add another layer of blue. Now this is the bank of the pond. I'm going to give it a little form. I mean, you don't have to match exactly what's in your picture. A lot of times there's no real interesting form in there, so they leave it up to you to decide where to put the darks. The contrast of dark and light is really what makes the picture pop and stand out, including color. Color pops, contrast pops. The visual focus. All right, so the recording stopped, and now we're looking at the finished product. You can see that I did a little more work on the water in the pond, kind of made it look swirly and radiating out from where the water's hitting. Also added a little blue and yellow into the sky. This is a greenhouse, there's a lot of light coming in. There's the sky area. And that's not really how it looked. And there's the water. The water was much darker. And then the leaves and how detailed they were. And then how I did the waterfall. So I hope you enjoyed this video. I hope you give it a try. Don't be afraid to do your own painting. Here's the finished product.